Today, I'm going to go through actually a very specific example of how a client leveraged Resonate data to solve for a business question that they had. And specifically, this example is derived from a major investment firm that sought to analyze in depth really a key segment of its customer base that it had really identified as presenting an opportunity to increase share of wallet relative to maybe some of the other firms that this key segment of customers had already invested money in, right? Because as we know, even for these major investment firms, there are competitive threats even within their existing set of customers in terms of the other firms with which they have money invested. And so really they wanted to leverage Resonate to kind of glean insight that could inform content, messaging strategies, brand and product positioning strategies as they really sought to engage at a deeper level and really grow these potentially high value customers that they currently had. And so really before getting into the actual insights here, I just wanted to level set, and apologies having some finicky Zoom things happening here, but really wanted to level set on some of the key terminology that that we're going to be relying on within the analysis that we're going to be going through here. And so the first term that I want to touch base on here is the baseline. And so baseline, you can think of this as sort of our starting point for comparison. So it's the audience against which all of the insights that we are going to be gleaning for our target audience is compared against. And so by default, the baseline typically is going to be our online adult population. And we can think of the online adult population as just all persons 18 plus who use the internet. And then the sort of key metrics that we leverage within analysis are going to be percent composition and index. So you can think of composition as sort of your measure of scale, and index is your measure of uniqueness. And so to kind of take that a step further and more granular and specific, percent composition is going to speak to kind of the proportion or percentage of the audience that you're looking at that has a given attribute or trait. And then index is going to kind of speak to how much more or less likely your audience is to have a specific trait or attribute as compared to your baseline or sort of the average adult online in this case. And so the next step before we kind of get into the specific insights, I also wanted to call out, as Chris mentioned, sort of one of the key value propositions of Resonate is the sort of connectivity and actionability as it relates to sort of the broader digital ecosystem. And so one of the things that I wanted to call out here and sort of the source of truth for this particular analysis here is that the client in this particular example actually imported insights or I should say a customer set from their existing CRM data source. And so by linking that and bringing that into our Ignite platform, we were able to essentially enrich their existing sort of base of knowledge around those consumers that they already interacted with across areas of and insights that they wouldn't normally be able to glean based on their sort of existing first-party data set, right? So we're pulling in their actual customers and being able to tell them in a lot more greater depth and granularity, what are the things that make them tick, that influence their day-to-day decision making, what are the attitudes that they have around financial services providers, and also just their general consumer preferences and the way they like to receive messaging, et cetera. And so with that, I'll jump into some of the specific insights. So this first set of insights here that we're looking at is derived from our personal values. And I think the personal values are always a really interesting insight to look at here, because if there's one thing that really the last year has shown us all is that, given all of these, high profile societal and political and cultural concerns that we have, we know there's a really broad subset of consumers that are really activist shoppers, and that it's really important for them that the brands that they work with align with the values that they hold dear. And even beyond those activist shoppers, right, it's really high value to be able to speak to kind of the core tenets of individuals' decision making as it relates to how they live their life, what determines the purchases they make, et cetera, that goes beyond just the basic demography and basic things that you probably already know about your current customer base, right? And so in this case, we're able to glean via the Ignite platform that this particular share of wallet target segment for this major financial services firm, investment firm, they're more likely to value things like security, more likely to value equality, as well as desire to care for their family and friends. And so as you think about, as the firm was, you know, viewing these insights, they're able to understand, okay, what makes them tick in terms of their day-to-day lives and decision-making, but also how can we tie our brand to align with some of these, position our brand to align with some of these key values, right? There's easy implications there from a security perspective, right? As it relates to the offerings that a financial services firm has and making sure that, you know, you're positioning yourself as secure and safe for consumers, but also, you know, aligning your corporate values and initiatives and corporate responsibility efforts to go along with these values is key as well. And then, and that's, you know, specific to things like equality, right? They care about equality and making sure that everyone's treated equally. So it won't just be about their own personal financial gain, but also making sure, you know, that there is equality of opportunities for all individuals. And then lastly, this value of caring for family and friends, right? It's not just for these consumers about achieving that wealth and being able to, you know, just do, you know, whatever they want and have that financial independence. While those things are certainly important, they also care about it from the lens of being able to be in a position to care for the people that are most important to them, right? And so again, lots of power in being able to leverage these things within this particular client's brand positioning and messaging as it relates to speaking to these existing customers for which they want to increase that share of wallet and deepen that relationship. On a similar vein, we also report on psychological drivers. So what are the things that really drive you from a day-to-day perspective? And so we can see in this case, this particular set of customers, they're really personally driven by a desire to achieve respect from others, as well as to maintain really an optimistic outlook on life. And so, you know, the takeaway here is that the firm should, in this case, should really seek to position itself as an opportunity or a vessel through which they can achieve these particular goals that drive them, right? A means to achieve that respect or a means to ultimately live their best life and maintain that optimistic outlook. As we start to get more specific into financial services attributes, one of the other questions that we ask about within our national consumer study is, you know, how would you describe the products and services within the financial services space that you tend to buy or that you tend to work with, right? And so I think there's a ton of power in this attribute because we're essentially allowing the customer in this case to pull from the descriptors that their customers use to describe the services that they like, and then be able to put that back feed that back into their sort of messaging strategies and the way that they're speaking about their products and positioning their products to align with the things that we know align, speak to the products and services that they like to buy within this space. And so in this case, we can see this customer set, they're really more likely to work with providers that they describe as cost-effective and safe. Again, safety, we're seeing that theme crop up again as we, in kind of aligning with the personal values that we saw on the previous slide, right? For this particular customer base, they want to know that this firm, that there are safety features and that their investments are going to be safe and that they are going to be protected in that way. And then also we can see this concept of practicality, right? Also popping for this audience. So they want ease of use and practicality as they're going through their sort of investment strategies. And so the next slide, we're looking specifically at how do they interact with their financial services firm and specifically their advisor. And so one of the takeaways here is that in this particular case, these individuals are more likely to be sort of independent decision makers when it comes to their investments. So they're more likely to either, as it relates to kind of their financial services provider or financial services advisor, I should say, more likely to make their own decisions, or at least, you know, if they are willing to hear that advice, they tend to hear it, take that as one of the, you know, one of their key inputs for making that decision, but ultimately make that decision on their own. And so really less, it's going to be for them less about leaning into the quality of advice that an advisor provides, and more about making sure that you're positioning or speaking to them about having the resources available to them to ultimately make the best decision for themselves when it comes to their investments, right? So again, really key distinction here from an investment, from a messaging perspective, that that Resonate is enabling that to kind of understand, kind of in greater depth, what are the attitudes that define and differentiate this particular customer segment. And when they are willing to work with an advisor, what are the things that ultimately influence that decision-making process, that influence the advisors that they do select, right? So in this case, we can see they're more likely to be concerned with factors like clear communication and personalized service. Those are really popping relative to average for this particular audience. And then lastly, and probably unsurprisingly, generates higher returns. Obviously, that's important for everyone, but it's even more important for these particular this particular customer segment, right? And so, again, as we think about their kind of independence in their decision making, that higher returns aspect is going to be really key for them, right? And being able to say, okay, you know, you are an independent decision maker, but if we want to be ingrained in kind of their day-to-day decision making, it's going to be on the basis of our ability to position ourselves as a means for them to achieve those higher returns and as another resource for them to ultimately make those correct decisions in the long run for themselves. And then taking a step back from some of those financial services attributes specifically, we can also take a broader look at their consumer preferences. This is just one quick example of how we can kind of understand how they interact with brands and how they interact with and how they sort of investigate their purchases. In this particular case, we can see these individuals are more likely to research products they buy across multiple different sources. So they're more likely to be comparison shoppers. And so those third-party review sites and comparison shopping sites are going to represent a key means for engaging with these individuals outside of the context of your sort of direct outreach, and also a means to engage with individuals that you aren't currently working with, but that look like these types of prospects across sort of the broader digital ecosystem and across different sort of competitor firms, right? And so in this particular case, again, comparison shopping is a differentiating factor for this particular segment. And then in terms of how do they prefer to receive their outreach, right? So this is really key in terms of making sure that the means in which you're engaging with them from a platform perspective is A, you know, going to be an efficient use of your resources, and B, isn't going to kind of be off-putting for them, right? And so obviously the messaging is important, but the means of delivery is also key as well. And in this particular case, we can see email is dramatically more important and more preferred than all other sort of channels of direct marketing outreach for the companies that they've already expressed interest in working with or are currently working with. And we can see conversely, direct outreach like phone calls or text messaging, they're about half as likely to prefer this as a means of being reached out to by the companies they've expressed an interest in. And so definitely something to consider as you think about what are the most efficient ways to engage with these individuals in terms of the channels that we're leveraging. And then taking a step back into the financial services space specifically, you know, one of the other attributes and key use cases for the client in this particular example is that they wanted to understand, you know, what are our key competitive threats beyond what we already know, right? They know who sort of the largest firms are in the space, but they don't know how much those firms are represented across this key customer segment in terms of the other firms that they have money invested with. And they also don't know which firms are over or underrepresented sort of relative to expectation across this customer base as well. And so leveraging these insights, they were able to understand, you know, what was the dominant firm from a scale perspective? What firm represented the largest portion of their customers in terms of the other firms that they have money invested with? And then also, what is a firm that is sort of overrepresented relative to average? And so you can see there were two specific competitive firms that they were able to call out and highlight as really significant competitive threats for this customer base that they needed to be able to proactively engage with as it relates to growing that share of wallet. And so to that, this next section here, within this next section, essentially the client asked us to take this the next step further, right? Going beyond just analyzing the share of wallet customer at a sort of broader perspective and really digging into that competitive set, right? Who are our customers that are engaged directly with these competitive threats, and how should our strategies differ for this competitive set relative to sort of the broader share of wallet segment overall? And in this case, I'll go quickly through these slides, but there were a couple differentiating points from a messaging perspective. We know security was important for the segment overall, but as we look at the competitive threat segment, which is in red here, it was even more important for these competitive share of wallet customers. And so security, again, something to lean into, and there's gonna be some overlap in some of those messaging strategies that'll work for the broader segment, but also for sort of the discrete competitive segment as well. But then secondarily, independence and that sort of freedom in determining their own actions as they live their life is really, really differentiated for this competitive segment relative to the share of wallet segment overall. And so again, leaning into this as a differentiating point, understanding, you know, how we can speak to independence as it relates to our brand and positioning the brand to align with these values is going to be key for this competitive grouping. Again, differentiators as well from a psychological driver's perspective. We can see, again, optimistic outlook pops, even to a greater extent for the competitive segment. We can also see creativity is really important. So thinking about positioning as it relates to sort of creative solutions for their finances and not a one-size-fits-all approach. But then also, how can the firm kind of speak to how they're enabling them to live out their sort of creative dreams and their creative lives? Again, going beyond just the general financial service positioning to go into kind of how these services tie into their goals as it relates to what they want to achieve in their life. And then again, in this case, proving competence and skills, presenting the firm as a means to be able to prove themselves relative to their peers and prove their competence, prove their skills as it relates to managing their money and achieving the goals that they have for themselves. A financial services product attributes, we can see, again, practicality sticks out. We can also see trustworthy and dependability. These are really key differentiators from a messaging perspective for this competitive segment. So important as you're speaking specifically to these competitive customers. And then also we can understand where do our existing strategies that we identified in the previous section, where do they align as it relates to this competitive segment? So what strategies overlap and what things where can we glean those efficiencies in terms of being able to implement existing or similar strategies for both sort of the broader and sub-segment groups. And so we can see comparison shopping is really key for this group, for both groups in specifically the competitive segment as well. And then again, we can see from an outreach perspective, email is really important for these folks, phone, text, direct mail, all less likely to be an efficient means of engaging with these customers. And so, again, really to kind of summarize what we went through here, really the kind of key takeaway is that by pulling in sort of their connected first party data, they're able to really enrich and gain a deeper understanding into kind of the messaging strategies, product positioning, brand positioning, and ultimately outreach strategies to really engage with and grow that relationship with these existing customer segments.